Hi, I'm Mike Bender, and thank you for taking the time to watch this presentation. And basically what my goal is for this is to give you some insight as to what makes a consistent golf swing and why Zach Johnson in particular has been so consistent over the last 10 years. You know, there's only three people that have won more tournaments than him over the last 10 years. Tiger, obviously, Phil Mickelson. You might have trouble with the third, but that's Vijay Singh, and then Zach Johnson. So he kind of flies under the radar, but it's amazing how consistently he has been over the last 10 years. And I think a lot of it's due to not only what a great competitor he is, but also the swing that he has. It's very efficient, it's very simple. The other thing I want to talk about is the TrackMan. The TrackMan launch monitor has come onto the scene, new technology. There's probably not been a piece of equipment that has had such a profound effect since the video camera. So it's really coming out. It's kind of in its infancy stages, but there's a lot of information about it now and the numbers. They call them the numbers. I think I even heard Sean Foley make a statement that says he doesn't even need to see his players' swings anymore. You know, he can just look at the numbers and he can help them by knowing what the numbers are. So we're going to talk about the numbers. And the one thing that I want to relay to you is I'm not an expert at the TrackMan. I'm in the infancy stages. I'm learning like everyone else out there. But what's interesting is I want to show you what the TrackMan numbers say about a swing like Zach Johnson or Jonathan Bird, somebody who has a very efficient and effective golf swing. And we're going to use the TrackMan to verify that instead of to teach from. So we're going to go over that. But the first thing I want to do to start out and to help you is there's a lot of physics involved in the golf swing. And I'm going to start out by giving you some definitions and some demonstrations of the physics that go into a golf swing. And basically, as a human being, we have the ability to be in harmony with physics when we swing a golf club, or we have the muscle strength and we can fight physics. And when we're fighting physics, then we're trying to overpower the ball and we're not going to be nearly as efficient as we would if we were more in harmony with the physics. And as we go along and I show you the demonstrations and we look at some video together, I think you're going to see how that all pans out. So let's take a look at the definitions and demonstrations of the physics. Now, when it comes to the golf swing, I think there's four main principles of physics that really apply, and I'm going to go over and show them to you. And then later we'll look at Zach's swing and we'll talk about how that actually applies to the golf swing. But first of all, there's a principle that says an object always swings fastest at 90 degrees to its axis. So here I have I just have a wood rod. It's like a tetherball. Remember the old tetherball pole standing straight up. Now I don't have this anchored, but the principle still applies. We've got a ball on the end of a string. Now if I swing this slowly, you can see that it's just kind of wrapping around in an elliptical orbit. But as I go faster and I start swinging the ball starts moving faster, just like when the kids would hit it. When they'd get it going faster, the rope actually would get shorter. The ball would come around this at 90 degrees. That's when it swings fastest. Matter of fact, if it's swinging slowly, just like I said, if it's swinging fast and then it slows down, it returns to kind of an elliptical orbit again. And we're going to show you how that applies to the golf swing when you're swinging and how your alignments can really make that happen. Because basically, this rod is your spine. And if your spine stays in the same place and you can rotate and things move at 90 degrees to it, you're going to have a pretty powerful and efficient golf swing. So now let's take a look at the definition of plane. So when it comes to swing plane, that's been kind of a mystery. There's been all kinds of ways of explaining it and different things, and I'm going to take my attempt as well. But really, if you look up the definition of plane, it means it's a straight line between three points. So if I have point A, B, and C, we draw a line, that's a definition of plane. And as it relates to the golf swing, I've got a CD that's in a box. And you can see that the CD here is round, okay? But if I turn it this way, it's straight. Okay, so when we're talking about plane, we want to be moving in a rotary motion, but we actually want to be moving in a straight line. Okay, and it sounds a little confusing at this moment, but when we show you how it relates to the golf swing, when we put Zach in there or somebody that swings the club on plane beautifully, then you're going to also understand that. But just keep in mind that this thing can go in a circle like this. It's going in a circle around very efficiently. But if you looked at it from this view, you would see that the circle would look like it's in a straight line. when you have that moving in different angles, just like the tetherball example, when it's wandering around and it's moving on all different angles, that's when you're not going to be very efficient, and you're going to have to use your strength and your hands and your upper body and everything to try to control and to manipulate the club, because you're not, again, you're not in harmony with physics. So we'll show you how this principle applies to the golf swing when we get inside. Now let's take a look at rotation. You know, when it comes to rotation, that's a pretty basic concept. Rotation, we all know, is circular, but but rotation can come in the form of, if I'm swinging this in a circle here, it can come in a form of more vertical, straight up and down, or it can be more like a helicopter this way, which is over my head, more level with the ground. When it comes to your body, rotation, the tighter the rotation, the more efficient it is, the more the circle stays the same. But when you have the body moving all over, rotation is disrupted. Just like if I'm swinging this thing in a circle, it's going pretty good, but if I start moving my arm all over, now it's more work, it doesn't move in a circle very well, and really kind of destroys the definition of rotation. So that word is very basic, but just remember, it's very tight. It means it's back and through, not a lot of side-to-side motion. Once again, we'll show you how that applies in the golf swing as we look at the video coming up. But before we do, the last principle is centrifugal force versus centripetal force. Two different words that you need to know why, what the definition of those are, and how that applies as well. So let's take a look at that. When it comes to motion, I'm going to talk about centripetal force first. And what centripetal force is, you have to understand motion. There's only in physics, there's only such thing as straight line motion. So in other words, if you shoot a gun, if I throw a spear, it's going to go straight, but then gravity would act on it as it slows down. It would act as the force that would make the object come down to earth, or it would make the bullet fall out of the sky. And that's called centripetal force. Anything that makes something in motion move in a curve, then that's a centripetal force. So like if I have this ball again on a string and I'm holding it, my hand right now is the centripetal force that is causing this ball to go in a circle. Okay, so that's centripetal force. Now, what happened was is they came along with a term called centrifugal force, or centrifugal force. And what that is that's a term that they gave to something that was in a circular motion that all of a sudden returned back to straight line motion. So if I'm moving in a circle like this, and I'm just gonna let go of this, okay, that ball, when I let go of it, it no longer had the centripetal force, so the ball returned and the string returned to a straight line motion, okay? So both of these principles apply in the golf swing, and I'm going to show you about it. In other words, if I'm accelerating and I'm moving in a circle, but then all of a sudden my arms continue in a straight line, that's more of a centrifugal force type swing. That's more of when people tend to swing inside out. They come down on plane, but they move out to the right. Someone who swings down from on plane and they get to impact and they go around and everything moves in a circle, that's more of a centripetal swing, which is more of what we would want in a golf, in a so-called technically correct golf swing. So we'll look at some illustrations of both of those, and it's important that you understand the difference in those terms, okay? So let's do this. Let's go in now and take a look at Zach's swing, some other swings, and kind of demonstrate some of these principles that I've been talking about so you can really see how it applies to the golf swing. Now that we've talked about some of the definitions and demonstrations of physics, let's see how it applies to Zach's swing and why Zach is such a consistent ball striker. So first thing I'm gonna do is I'm drawing a line up the shaft. They call this the original shaft plane. So there's your straight line there. And as he starts back, you're gonna see that the hands and the club are just tracking that. And that's because the rotation of the body is what's taking the club back. So he's rotating, the hands are on that line. And as he continues to turn, he creates what they call depth. And depth is everything, if we go back and look at the start of the swing, I'm gonna draw another line here. Everything that's on this side of the line is called depth. Okay, so the rotation of your body in the backswing should create depth of your hands. So you can see how his hands are moving on an arc. They're moving up that plane. Let me get rid of these numbers again, or these lines. Now, when we get halfway back, you can see how he has his hands are about even with the bicep, which is the proper depth. And as he gets to the top of the backswing, kind of the first principle that we talked about in the physics is that his left arm is 90 degrees to his spine, and his spine is the axis. So that's where you want to be. If your arms are higher or they're lower, you know, they would call that a real flat swing. The other one would be an upright swing. So this would be an on plane. It'd be the alignments would be proper. It'd be 90 degrees to his spine. Okay, now on the downswing, this is where it starts to come in to play, where I talked about straight line, a plane right to the ball. So watch the path of his hands. The hands are going to track straight down. They're going to be touching that line, and then they're going to stay on that line all the way up on the other side. So he has straight line acceleration right toward the golf ball. Okay, and you're going to see, in order to make that work, you're going to see that his hands start coming down, but watch his knees here. You're going to see that the knees are barely moving, and by the time the knees are square, the hands are well below the waist. That's the proper sequencing. Now the rotation kicks in, and that's what allows the club to go around in a circle on the other side. So the rotation on the backswing brings the hands in. The rotation on the downswing brings them around to the inside on the follow-through side. Now, a couple other things I want to point out as it relates to physics is you can see here that the shaft of the club is 90 degrees to the spine again on the downswing. So right here, you see the left arm 90 degrees to the spine, and now you see the shaft come down 90 degrees to the spine. So he's working the hands and the shaft around the body on what we call on plane. That's what I would call an on plane hand swing as far as the direction that the hands are traveling, okay? So this line is very important, and you'll see players that have their hands too high. In a little bit, I'll go back outside and I'll demonstrate some of the variations about that. But what they call this is they call this the shaft getting shallow early and then steeper later due to the rotation. Because rotation of the body always brings everything out on the downswing, meaning if you rotate too early, it'll bring your hands out, it'll bring the club out. But if your hands accelerate toward the ball, which he does a very good job of, now his arm is in front of him, the shaft is right on plane here, right through the middle of the right forearm, 90 degrees to the spine, and now from there, he has a direct line delivery right to the golf ball, and then matches up on the follow-through side. And if we take a look from the front view, I'm going to draw a line here, and we'll draw a circle around his head. And remember I said in the physics part that an object swings fastest, you know, around the axis at 90 degrees, and the axis must stay fixed or still. So when he's turning away, you're going to see the head did not move at all, and you're going to see this gapping of the hips. Oops, wrong one here, right here. You're going to see a gapping of the hips. And that allows his spine angle to remain constant without any movement back and forth or side to side or up and down. So, and now you're going to see coming down, comes down, and you can see the hands forward, and then the hips will match up. Starting from about waist high, the hips rotate, and that matches up through the ball. And if we slide him over a little bit, you're going to be able to see here that the club face is not really doing much. It's moving. With each click of the camera, you're going to see the right arm and the shaft going together all the way around. So there's no deviation there. So the hands and the club are moving in sync with the body through impact and post-impact. And that's what keeps the club face square and online longer. Okay, so in closing here, and just looking at it, this position at the top is critical to being able to move your hands and the club and straight down toward the ball. And you'll see a lot of players, their hands will drop more vertically, or some players what they call come over the top, and in any case it makes the swing less efficient. Okay, so let's go back out on the range for a moment, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the variations and give you a demonstration where you can actually see me doing that. And then what we'll do is we'll come back in and we'll do a little more work, start looking at TrackMan numbers and so forth. Okay, so I just wanted to demonstrate out here just some of the variations. Now that we've looked at Zach's swing, we've talked about sequencing, we've talked about the hand plane moving at the ball. The one thing, if I set up to a golf ball here, if I take a ball in my hand and I turn back and I fire this ball at that ball in a straight line, okay? Now, I just about hit that, and I should try to hit that ball. It's actually a very good drill, but if I turn back and I fire that, you can see I hit that ball right on the back of the ball, and both balls went off to the right. So that's straight line acceleration. Okay, that's like moving straight down toward the ball, and the centrifugal force is trying to throw everything to the right. That's why sequencing is so important. Down at the ball, and you're accelerating in a straight line, or in plane is a better way, just like remember the CD disc, it's moving in a circle, but it was actually going in a straight line. So from this view, it looks like I'm moving in a straight line like Zach's hands did. And as I get down to here, as my hands get below the waist, it's important for my body then to rotate, and that's the centripetal force that makes my hands and the club and everything go around in a circle. Much like the skaters, you know, when they want to spin in a circle, they pull in, they swing really fast. When they throw their arms out, they slow down. So if my hands and arms are running away from my body, if the centrifugal force is throwing them away, the club is actually going to slow down. But if my rotation is very tight and at the right time, then that actually speeds the club head up through the golf. Just very much like, again, another example is the boat and the water skier. They're going along in the straight line, then the water or the boat makes the sharpest corner and the water skier really whips around the end. But the key is they had to be going in a straight line first, and they had to be going fast first before they took the corner. The golf swing, I've got to be moving, accelerating my hands and arms as fast as I can first before I make the corner. If I make the corner too early, that's the sequential problem. I start turning too early, which is very common in the golf swing. Then that's going to cause the hands not to move in a straight line, and it's going to be like the boat making the corner before it ever got going in a straight line. It's going to drag the skier through the water. It's not going to be very efficient. It's going to be more strength oriented. And so that's what we call being steep early. If I get over here, the club shaft is very steep early, and then a lot of times players will try to shallow it out at the bottom, and it's very inefficient, and there's a lot of compensating parts. On the other hand, if the shaft is very shallow early, so in the downswing, the hands are moving at the ball and the shaft is shallow, now the rotation takes place and that brings the club around, and I can go right on around in a circle properly. So the sequence is very important. The last thing is the position at the top, the depth we talked about. We talked about the left arm being on the shoulder plane, 90 degrees to the spine, having the proper depth. It's extremely important for the hands to be able to move straight towards the ball. Because if my arms are too high, and if I move my hands straight to the ball now, I would have to uncock the club in this manner right here. It's almost impossible to do. So players that have their arms too high, as they swing down, they have to move their hands in too early toward their body to be able to put the club head on the ball. So now their hand plane is not as efficient as it could be in moving in that perfect arc around the body. So it's really important, the depth of the swing like you saw in Zach's swing, and the starting point really is important if you're going to use the principles of physics in your favor. Now let's go back inside and look at Zach's swing again and what TrackMan has to say about it. Okay, here we are with Zach at the Honda Classic this year, and for the week he was number one in driving accuracy, and he was number four in greens in regulation, which which was far better than the player who won the tournament. Now, he didn't putt very good that week, so I think he finished like 35th or 38th or something. But if we watch his golf swing here, I was on the driving range at the tournament here, and I was taking a video of his swing, and then I'm going to pan over to the TrackMan. So you can see his shaft is perfectly on plane there, and just like we talked about earlier, his hands come right down the line, shaft right through the right forearm, into impact, great impact position with his shoulder square. Now as he's rotating, his hands go right on around and right up the line on the follow through side. And Zach is a drawer of the ball. He hits a ball that starts out right and comes back to the left. And he hits very few hooks, however, but he has hit a consistent draw. So now let's take a look at what the TrackMan says about that golf swing, which I would call an on-plane swing. So we're gonna zoom in here and then just hold it. And what I'd like to point out, first of all, is there's really four numbers that make a difference when you're using it for teaching and understanding your golf swing. And one of them is right here, the club path. And you can see that his club path was 6.8 degrees from the inside. And then the second number is what's called the attack angle. The attack angle means how much is he hitting down on the ball. That's what makes you take a divot. You have to have a negative attack angle to hit a divot. So he's hitting down on the ball 3.7 degrees. The next number is the face to the path. In other words, what is the face at impact relative to the path? And in his case, his face is 3.4 degrees open to the path, which is 6.8 from the inside. And if you look at those numbers, it's an exactly 50% difference. And if you're going to hit a draw, you want your club face close slightly to the path, whichever path, and 50% we found to be a pretty good number to hit a consistent draw. Now here's the one number that may surprise some people who use TrackMan a lot, and that's called the swing direction. And basically that's the bottom of the swing plane board, and when he was 4.1 degrees from the inside. Now when I first was introduced to TrackMan, they were trying to talk to me, the people who invented TrackMan were trying to talk to me a little bit about trying to zero out the numbers, meaning try to have that path at zero and that face at zero, and try to get the numbers, a swing direction at zero. And to do that, I just don't think you're gonna be swinging on plane if you do that with our definition of on plane. So I wanted to throw these numbers out so we can start to create a conversation amongst the teachers, amongst the people in the industry. And I think what you have is you have people who fade the ball and hit the ball left to right, and people who hit the ball right to left. So if you're going to draw the ball, you know, what kind of numbers should we be looking at? And I think Zach demonstrates that probably as well as anybody. And the other thing that I would mention is this path, this 6.8 degrees, may give some people the wrong impression that means that he's swinging, let's say, inside, outside 6.8 degrees. But that's really not what that is. It's relative to the attack angle. If the more he hits down on the ball, the more the path will be out to the right and so forth. So it can get kind of confusing, but I would look to the path and the face angle being at 50%. This was a 6-iron, by the way, and with a 6-iron, you always want to hit down, and that number, 3.7 to maybe 5.0 right in there, is pretty much average. But this swing direction, it's okay to get out there at 4 degrees and try not to be at zero, and you're seeing that he's one of the most consistent ball strikers there is with those numbers. Okay, so now what we're going to do is I'm going to go out, and I want to show you outside a little bit. If you're going to use TrackMan or get on TrackMan, I want to show you some of the precautions I think are very important, because once again, if you're just looking at the numbers and you don't know some of these other things, it can be confusing, and you can get some wrong readings because you're at the mercy of whoever is reading these numbers. Okay, so let's go take a look at that. Okay, so we took a look at Zach's TrackMan number. And I think that when you're using the TrackMan, you know, I was told initially that it didn't really matter where you aim, because I said, well, where do we have to aim? They go, well, it doesn't really matter, because all that matters is what the club data is having coming into the ball relative to the target line. But I think when it comes to your swing, it's really important to be lined up properly so we can get some consistent numbers based on the shape of the shot, number one, and where you're aiming. So I would recommend, and I shoot everybody, or we use the TrackMan with everybody standing parallel left of their target line. So make sure the TrackMan is aimed at something precise. In this case, the left edge of the red board out there. Then what we're gonna do is we're gonna set up and make sure that our feet and body lines are parallel to that. Then when we start making swings, we can really get some accurate data based on the swing plane and the mechanics of the golf swing, and then what that's producing, like we did with Zach, and seeing those numbers. Because I will tell you that if I set up a little bit open and I have the same exact swing where the shaft comes down shallow, I release and turn through, all the numbers are going to be different than as if I was standing parallel to the target line. So it's really important, I think, that how you set up to this. And especially if I want to change my numbers for and make them better in one way or the other, you know, it's kind of like somebody who's slicing the club and say, okay, we'll just close the club face at address and that'll fix that. To me, that's kind of a little bit of a Band-Aid approach. But instead of changing the swing plane or the swing direction to help change the flight of the ball. So I want to try to make sure that my numbers are consistent every time I get them on the TrackMan. And so I would highly recommend that's how you set it up when you're taking numbers. And like I said earlier, it's important to understand whether the player is trying to hit a fade or a draw to that target line. So in that case, if they're hitting a fade and they're a left to right player, then they would set up open to the target line. But if they set up that same way, that's the key. You set up the same way all the time, then the numbers will reflect that setup and how it relates to the target line. You know, again, so make sure that that's in place. And if you do, then we're going to be able to really get some consistent numbers. You're going to be able to learn something from those numbers. But the TrackMan is only as good as the owner and the operator. And it's just like using a video camera. There's a lot of players that will tend to put the video camera or people on the ball line. But if I turn this way, my swing looks totally different than if I turn this way or I turn this way if the camera never changes. And that's kind of the effect that you're getting on the TrackMan. So make sure that everything is consistent and it's going to be a lot better for you as you move forward. Okay, I just wanted to show you a few other people's swings because, again, there's been a lot of talk over the years that, you know, people are swinging too much from the inside and you shouldn't do that. It's a bad thing. But I think it's really important to understand there's a difference between the shaft coming down from the inside and the hands coming from the inside. So here on the right, you'll see Jeff Maggart. On the left, you'll see Mac O'Grady, two great ball strikers. And then we're going to take a look at Mo Norman, actually, and Jim Furyk, and a couple of other really good ball strikers. And we're going to look what happens here. So coming down, as they come down, and by the way, you notice that both of them, their left arm is right on their shoulder plane, 90 degrees to their spine. So much like what we saw Zach doing. But now coming down, if you take a look, the hands are moving right toward the ball. And look at the shaft of the club now. It's lined up right through the right forearm. And you're going to see the next frame. Now you see the shaft well underneath the forearm. And so a lot of people would say, boy, that's way too much from the inside. And they would think that you would not want to do that. And they would say that would cause you to swing too much out to the right and flip your hands or use too much hand action. But in reality, both of these players are what I call shallow early. So the club shaft is very shallow early in the downswing. And then they really start to rotate. So watch the next frame here. Now, if you see that, you'd probably go, that doesn't look too much from the inside anymore. It looks pretty accurate right there. And if you see the next shot, as they keep going, they're going to go right on around. The rotation's kicking in, and their hands do not swing out to the right, but yet they swing right on around using that centripetal force and coming out. And so two swings that you probably see them side by side, you wouldn't think they look too much alike, those players. But when you look at it under the microscope, you see that they are actually very, very similar and also demonstrating what we call good technique and good mechanics. So, you know, in a little bit, I'm going to talk about you know, what happens when you do swing too much from the inside, or what causes that, and then also what's the fix. But these players, there's nothing wrong. And if you look at, in history, if you look at the shallow swings, and you look at Lee Trevino, Sergio Garcia, Tom Lehman, all of those players have very, very, what they call very shallow shaft angles, and they all have one thing in common. You know, they're great ball strikers. And you see that in these two players here. Now let's take a look right now at Jim Furyk and Mo Norman, which are two diverse setups. And let's look at how they shake out here. Okay, now here we have Jim Furyk on the right and Mo Norman on the left. And probably not going to find two more different setups. I mean, look at Mo Norman over there. He's probably further from the golf ball than anybody that I ever saw hit a golf ball. And then you got Jim Furyk, who probably is closer to the golf ball than anybody I ever saw. So if you watch these guys and you watch their swings, you're gonna see Jim Furyk has very little rotation of his body going back. He has mostly all arms, and his arms go straight up. And most all of us know, you know, have known his swing for years, because he's always in contention and we've seen it so much. So there he is at the top with very little rotation. His left arm is a long way from that 90 degrees to the spine position that we think is correct or more efficient. So here's Mo Norman. Now he's taking it back. Now he's going to go around. He's going to do the opposite, and he's going around. And actually, if you look at Mo Norman's swing at the top, he's actually really in our position that we think is correct, with the left arm on the shoulder plane, and all the alignments for him is correct. Now watch what happens when he comes down. His hands again are going to track toward the golf ball, and there you see the shaft lining up right through the forearm, like we saw with Mac O'Grady and Jeff Maggart. Now look what Jim Furyk is having to do here. Because of his position at the top, he's very, very high. He's going to have to really reroute his hands. Look at his hands dropping. And if I get to the top and I actually draw a line straight down, you're going to see how they really drop behind. And so he has to create his depth, so to speak, on the downswing. And then look where he comes down now. Now look where that shaft is, and look where Mo Norman is. And you're going to see now they're both in the same position. So they both got that shaft shallow. You can see the shaft is below the forearm there. Again, most teachers modern day or philosophies would say that's way too much from the inside. But then the rotation of Jim Furyk and Mo Norman is going to take that club right on around. You can see he's at a great impact position. And Jim Furyk has to be in a much different position to be able to hit it with his being so close to the ball. But they both come around. They don't swing to the right. They both move around on an even arc over here, and they're incredible ball strikers. So there's a lot of ways, a lot of different styles in the setup or the position at the top of the backswing that can work. But if you get, they all get that shaft down on that forearm, they get that shaft being coming in from on plane, and that's one of the reasons why they're so consistent as they are. So what I'd like to show you now is I'd like to go outside and talk a little bit about some of the things that I see and some of the problems that I'm seeing that people are talking about too much from the inside. A few of the common questions that people have once we talk about this philosophy. You know, addressing some of the common questions that we get and even some misconceptions, I think, on certain problems and how to fix them. And one of the most common ones is, like we've talked about so far in the video, about this common perception that people, you know, you don't want to swing too much from the inside. And is it possible to swing too much from the inside? And absolutely it is. And here's a couple of the ways that people do it. Number one, they get to the top of their backswing and they do what Jim Furyk does, which is they drop their hands vertical. And when they drop vertically, their right elbow gets trapped behind their body, and typically they're not as good as Jim Furyk at squaring the club up. So then that causes them to bottom out fat or hit some bad shots or have a poor impact position. That's one way. Another way is, and it's very common amongst better players, is to change the posture. In other words, the butt kind of goes in, the head goes back, and the spine angle actually increases backward. And what that does is, you can see as I start down, you can see how that drops the club kind of what they call underneath or too much to the inside. So in the past, we've seen a lot of people talk about fixing that by coming more out here. And I think you can even see Tiger Woods doing that right now. You see his practice swings look like this. They look like he's trying to hit an intentional slice. But what he's doing is he's trying to get out of the club and the hands coming too much from the inside. So what I'd like to have you consider and think about is that if you get to the top of your swing in position where the left arm is on the shoulder plane like we've talked about, from there, if the hands and arms have the ability or the freedom to accelerate toward the ball, if they do that, there's no reason why I would need to change my posture. There's no reason why I'm going to have to let my hands drop, because if I move my hands straight towards the ball, then the shaft is going to be nice and shallow right down my forearm where it should be. I'm going to be able to stay in my posture, and I'm going to get my right elbow in front of me so that as I rotate, that can take everything right on around. Okay? So I believe the fix is getting a good position at the top, number one. Number two, getting those arms to move. And most people don't have freedom in the arms this way. They have so much tension in their arms that they have to move their body, and the higher handicappers will move their body and come over the top, and the better players will do the same move early where the club gets steep early. Then they've got to try to figure out a way to shallow it at the bottom. So either way creates a lot of havoc and a lot more timing that's necessary in the golf swing to hit good shots. So get up to the top and keep working on the hand plane moving at the ball, just like Zach did. You saw his hands get down in front of him, then his hips rotated, went right on around, and everything was in sync. And everything is what they call matched up through the golf ball. You know, another question I get is face angle control, and players will spray the ball around right and left because the face angle is not right at impact. And some of the causes for that is, again, in poor sequencing. I see players way out ahead with their hips, then their hips slow down, and then the club head catches up and passes by, and they rotate the club too much or flip the wrist. Or there's players that come out over the top and the club casts, causing a scooping motion and a chicken wing through the ball. So loss of face angle control is really a big byproduct of sequencing and then also just habit. And so if you get your sequencing right, like we've been talking about, of getting the hands to move on that straight line toward the ball, then the body rotates hard, my hips start rotating hard through the ball, then I can have a very good impact position. And just like Zach did, I can control the face through the impact area without letting it flip and without letting it have excess rotation. So a lot of that's just, it works on the sequencing is so important in the golf swing, and you don't want just swinging with all arms, and you don't want your body out ahead of your arms. You want to be able to sync them up, much like the example of jumping. When I jump, I go like this. I'm going to go really hard with my arms, and then I'm going to jump. So it's going to look like this. I mean, that just looks normal. I would never jump and then throw my arms up. Or I'd never throw my arms up and all the way and then jump. So the sequencing in the golf swing's the same way. I want to get my arms in front of my body, and I got to have the freedom to do that. And I want to get those arms moving at the ball. Then I can match up, and then I can fire those hips and rotate and use the rotation to take me right on around and control the club face. There's other drills that we do to work on that, but it's important to understand why you lose that face angle, why you have that poor impact. You know, it's very important to understand the effects of rotation. We've talked about rotation throughout the presentation. And just remember, rotation takes everything around, right? It's rotation. That's why it is rotation. It goes around this way. Rotation takes everything this way. So if you take it back, as you take it back, you want to rotate. That's what creates the depth and your good position here. But the sequencing, as I come down and I get my arms down in front of me, now if I rotate, that takes me around on this side. So if I come down and now I get my rotation in sync with my arms, everything goes on around here, fold right up into the finish. So rotation, just like with Zach's swing, he stays very rotary, very centered, doesn't have a lot of movement back and forth. So rotation is critical, but when the rotation happens, that's the key. And that's that all of these things that I've been talking about, coming too much from the inside, loss of face control, rotation, it all centers around sequencing. And in every swing, even the swings that you see on the PGA Tour that are all different, Jim Furyk, for instance, has a particular sequence that makes it work. And what we're trying to do, and what I'd like you to consider, is how can you make that sequence most natural? And just like the jumping example I gave, if I get my arms moving and I get them moving at the ball, straight line acceleration toward the ball, and then I move my body, now we have the right sequencing and we're going to have a very efficient golf swing. You know, in tying all this together, I think it's important to understand there's no one way to swing, and as evidence of all the different swings everybody has from the PGA Tour to the beginners. So, but the one thing about it is that I think that technology has let us start to get a better glimpse, due to the TrackMan and other things like this, of what impact position should be and what are the components of a good impact position, because no matter what, that's the one spot in the golf swing that has to be repeating in order to be consistent at the game, which is what so many people wanna have. So every time there's cause and effect, as we've talked about, there's cause and effect, and that cause and effect and that sequencing that I've been talking about as well, all has an effect on impact position, which if I come down and I can line up into impact position every time, if my head of the club and my shaft reach that same point every time with the club facing the same point, I'm gonna hit the ball like Iron Byron, because that's what it does. So keep in mind, this is just a discussion to kind of shed some light on our philosophy as far as how it relates in some of the principles of physics that apply, some of the sequential movements that I think are important in the golf swing. And then you decide, you can go from there. But when you use that TrackMan, again, I think it's very important to understand the overall philosophy of the instructor that's using it with you and what that they are gonna try to accomplish by using that with you, helping you with the numbers and so forth. So hopefully you've gotten a little bit out of this. If you have any questions, always interested in that, we can email me at my facility at megzagolf@aol.com, and just take a look at our website, which is mikebender.com. Thanks a lot.